with CyberMedics.org, and we're here today to clear up some of the confusion about security keys. If you're still on the fence about whether you need one or not, I recommend you view the video Billions of Accounts Hacked, linked in the description below. So with that, let's get started. Before we talk about particular security keys, I think it's important to go over the whole concept of two-factor authentication, which probably most of you are familiar with. You're logging in with a user ID and a password, something you know, and then you're providing an additional layer of authentication with something you have, either a one-time passcode, a text message, code that's been sent to you, or something you are, a biometric thumbprint or facial scan. So the first method would be telephone. You log into your bank account, they want to authenticate after you put in your password, give you a code that you type in, a PIN number, and then you get access to the account. The security problem with PINs through telephone is that phones can be hijacked. Your SIM can be swapped, someone can emulate your telephone number, intercept that PIN. Really not a great way to do second-factor authentication. Another way to do second-factor authentication is through something called an authenticator application. We'll get into that later and actually showing you the details of that. But what you do is you log into your account, you authenticate that account with an authenticator app. That app now is synced with your account, and every time you log in, you will click that app and it will generate a one-time passcode. That's usually a six-digit number. That six-digit number is then keyed in, just like if you had received a text message with a code, and you key it in, and then you're authenticated to your account. Even though it is more secure than an SMS text message, it does have its own set of vulnerabilities. The central vulnerability is that the secret key that you're using to generate that particular passcode is stored both by the service provider, and it's also stored on your authenticator app. So if somebody gets a hold of that key, just like if they got a hold of your password, they would have access, full access to your account. The other vulnerability of it is that there's no certification that you're actually on the right site when you go to key it in, so potentially you could be subject to a phish attack and you wind up keying in that code on the wrong site and then somebody has access to your account. Let's go to the third method, which is being strongly advocated by security professionals and security organizations today, and that is an actual physical security key. These keys plug into your phone, your computer, your tablet, etc. Anywhere you would authenticate to an online application, they would plug in and you interface with them through a touch. So why is this particular implementation of authentication more secure? Well, they use something called a public-private key pair. The private key is stored electronically and internally in the hardware security device. The public key is stored on the servers of the provider that you're trying to authenticate to. And the process goes like this. You put in your user ID and login like normal. The provider then generates a challenge back. That challenge is then signed and encrypted using your private key. It is then sent back to the service provider, who can then unencrypt it with your public key and verify that there was no changes to the challenge. Now, in addition to that registration process that you, when you initially initiated that key, it gives another level of assurity that you're on the right site when you actually go to authenticate. So this implementation is much more secure. I am not saying this is not hackable. I'm just saying that in order for you to provide the highest level of security for your accounts today, this is the best implementation of security that we have to protect your accounts. And it's significantly orders of magnitude more difficult to hack this than any of the other two-factor authentication methods that we discussed earlier. Hope you found the video informative. This will be part of a multi-part series, so please consider subscribing so you can be notified. Thanks again for watching.